It's new, Doctor.
New Year's Eve, which reunites Gary Marshall with the writers of Valentine's Day. You remember how much we enjoyed that? Yet again, it's that time of year, so we have something that's not so much a movie as a guest list. Here is the here's the central theme of this. And bear in mind, you know, for all of those listening in the UK, the focal point for New Year's Eve is the countdown to 2012, represented by the ceremonial ball drop in Times Square. Imagine one person being responsible for seeing that this spectacle goes off without a hitch, live, while the eyes of the world watch. I mean, I can barely imagine the excitement of one person overseeing the New York Times Square ball drop, because that's certainly a big thing for me every year. Is it for you?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Do you sit there worrying about the New York Times Square ball drop? Do you have any idea what it is?
What we do?
Do you care in the slightest bit?
You're not actually... You don't want me to contribute.
No, I do. Do you? Do you?
Well, it's either that or... Jules Holland. It's one of the two. Either the ball drop or...
Have you ever actually known what the New York Times Square ball drop is?
It takes place in New York.
Yes.
And they have a big ball. And it drops.
Or maybe it doesn't. Maybe, and here's the real dramatic meter, maybe it will get stuck. Just think of the drama potential. The ball's not dropping. The ball's stuck at the top of a... And New Year's Eve is coming. It's a whole film about that. And meanwhile, while we're waiting for the ball to drop, all these other stories are going on around them. One of them involves a man who's dying.
Robert De Niro.
Yeah. Earning the rent. Paying the checks.
I thought he was just having bored.
And there's a gag reel at the end when he's in his deathbed and then he makes a joke. Actually, the only thing... I mean, here's the thing. The film is horrible almost beyond belief. I've talked a lot about diminished expectations, about how much we've come to accept stuff which is so subpar that actually in any sort of former age, you know, cinemas would just shut down rather than show it. But what's happened here is, you know, you just get together the hideous guest list, you get together all these intertwining stories, all of which, I mean, they're so repugnant, so revolting, so horrible that I actually thought I am going to be sick. And I haven't thought I was going to be sick like that since Human Centipede 2, which was actually...
What, really sick?
Yeah, I thought I was actually going to throw up. I was actually... The feeling of vulgar, saccharine horror was so clawingly appalling, I thought I'm going to throw up. But what was really interesting about the film was this. The film is so loathsomely putrid and terrible that actually even people whose expectations have been diminished beyond belief hate it. I think it's quite interesting in that even the most undemanding, most uninterested, you know, critics all the time get accused of being snobs, right? Oh, you like snobby cinema. You don't have any idea what people actually like. Nobody will enjoy New Year's Eve. Nobody.
They will. Okay?
No, they won't. No, they won't. Genuinely won't. Even people who love this sort of, you know, nonsense will feel ill. It's a movie that's so bad, even stupid people will hate it. And that, in a way, is its great saving grace. You look at it, and the cinema, the screening that I saw it in, I mean, afterwards we came out, and three or four people came out from very, very different, you know, points of view on,
all critics,
all
not normal people,
all yeah. looking like they had been smacked around the head with a large leg of. Yes, fine. You say they are critics. What I'm saying is, when it gets out there into the real world, people will pay to see it because it's got the unsinkable guest list. Okay,
well, it doesn't sound like a great guest list, though.
Well, you know, I mean, it's a bankable guest list, isn't it? It's got, you know, Robert De Niro, Josh Duhamel, Zac Efron, even Here's how bad it is. Even Zac Efron can't save it. Zac Efron is the best thing in the film. Of course he is, because he's got fabulous hair and he's Zac Efron. But even the might of Zac Efron starts to be crushed under the horrible tidal wave of vomitous, pulchritudinous filth.
Vomitous.
Honestly,
excellent.
It is like something that you would sick up after having eaten all the nasty consumerist porn of Christmas. This is like the vomit furball at the end of it. But the best thing is, no one will like it.